Hello and welcome to the YouTube channel Misha Impossible. I am Mikhail Sergeyev, or Professor Misha, as my students call me by my Russian nickname. Before we start, please remember to like this video, subscribe to my channel, and push the little bell button if you enjoy my educational videos and want to receive notifications about upcoming projects. And now, let's begin. In the categories, Aristotle distinguishes between primary and secondary substances. In this video, I will present and explain this distinction and discuss how Aristotle's position differs from Plato's. In contrast to the dialogues of Plato, which were well preserved by his disciples and later generations, the works of Aristotle came to us having been arranged approximately 200 years after Aristotle's death, that is, in the first century before Christ, by a Greek philosopher named Andronicus of Rhodes. Andronicus belonged to the school of Stoicism, which claimed ethics as the most crucial philosophical discipline. Thus, Andronicus appropriately ordered the Corpus Aristotelicum, starting with Aristotle's logical treatises and culminating with his works on ethics. According to this tradition, the short logical treatise Categories is placed by Aristotle's first editor as the starting point of the analytical works concerned with the technique and the principles of proof, grouped under the name of the Organon. In their turn, the categories deal with, I quote, simple, uncombined terms treated under 10 most universal heads, or categories, end quote. The word category in Greek literally means an accusation of something. And at the time of Aristotle, it was used in courts. As for Aristotle himself, in categories, he is, so to speak, accusing the nature of being structured in a certain way. Aristotle also opposes Plato's understanding of substance and sketches his philosophical project later developed in metaphysics. Aristotle introduces two important distinctions at the beginning of the categories in chapter 2. One is about the forms of speech, simple, like man runs, or composite, like man runs. The second applies to things that can be predicable and or present in a subject. For example, I quote, man is predicable of the individual man and is never present in a subject, while by the latter, Aristotle means being capable of existence apart from the said subject, end quote. The other two groups of things mentioned by the author are either present in, but never predicable of, or both predicable of and present in a subject. Finally, the fourth class represents the things being, I quote, neither present in nor predicable of a subject, such as the individual man or the individual horse, end quote. In chapter 3 of the categories, Aristotle returns to the first group of things while explaining the difference between genus and species. He points out that all that is predicable of a subject's predicate will also be predicable of the same subject. For example, man, he says, I quote, is predicated of the individual man, but animal is predicated of man. It will therefore be predicable of the individual man also, for the individual man is both man and animal, end quote. Aristotle begins the next chapter of his book by enumerating 10 basic categories that present how reality is or gets offered to us. I quote, expressions which are in no way composite, he claims, signify substance, quantity, quality, relation, place, time, position, state, action, and affection, end quote. Explaining roughly their meaning by giving illustrations for each category, he mentions, among others, some examples of substance, which are man or horse. Chapter 5 is wholly dedicated to examining the first in the line of the categories, namely the category of substance. Here Aristotle makes his essential distinction between primary and secondary substances. I quote, "Substance, in the truest and primary and most definite sense of the word," he affirms, "is that which is neither predicable of a subject nor present in a subject, for instance, the individual man or horse. But in the secondary sense," Aristotle continues, "those things are called substances within which, as species, the primary substances are included, also those which, as genera, include the species." End quote. For example, the species man and the genus animal are understood by Aristotle as secondary substances because, I quote, "the individual man is included in the species man, and the genus to which the species belongs is animal." Thus, the primary substances belong to the fourth class of things. We are back in chapter 2. And the secondary substances belong to the first one accordingly. Only the latter, namely species and genera, express the primary substance by determining, I quote, "the quality with reference to a substance. They signify substance qualitatively differentiated," end quote. Furthermore, of secondary substances, the species are closer to the primary substance than the genus, and therefore are more certain substances than the latter. For one should, I quote, "render an account more proper to the subject of what a primary substance is, by stating the species rather than by stating the genus," end quote. As for the species, no one is more definitely substance than another. This is also true for the primary substances in a way that, I quote, "an individual man is not more truly substance than an individual ox," end quote. In general, it is also said that primary substances represent a foundation for all other things. As Aristotle puts it, I quote, "everything except primary substances is either predicated of primary substances or is present in them, and if these last did not exist, it would be impossible for anything else to exist," end quote. Being understood as such basic or first subjects, primary substances for Aristotle are particulars and signify that which is individual. Finally, Aristotle thinks the ability to receive contraries is the main characteristic of primary substances. I quote, "It is a distinctive mark of substance," he says, "that while remaining numerically the same, it is capable of admitting contrary qualities, the modification taking place through a change in the substance itself," end quote. For example, another quote, "the same individual person is at one time white, at another black, at one time warm, at another cold, at one time good, at another bad," end quote. Being a student of Plato for approximately 20 years, Aristotle agrees with his teacher about the importance of substance. This is the Greek word ousia. Both thinkers understand ousia as an ontological and or explanatory foundation of all, a fundamental principle of philosophy. However, Plato claims substances to be universals, or forms, by participation in which everything else exists. On the other hand, Aristotle points out that Plato's universals belong to the secondary substances, in contrast to particulars, which are the primary ones. I quote, "primary substances are most properly called substances," Aristotle says, "in virtue of the fact that they are the entities which underlie everything else and that everything else is either predicated of them or present in them," end quote. In his later works, especially in Metaphysics, Aristotle further criticizes Plato's theory of forms and develops his position regarding substance. However, the seed of Aristotle's views is already present in the categories. As I mentioned above, it consists of the distinction between primary and secondary substances and Aristotle's understanding of the former. And this concludes my discussion of Aristotle's distinction between primary and secondary substances. In my video, I presented and explained this distinction and explored how Aristotle's position differs from Plato's. Please leave your questions, comments, and suggestions in the chat section under this video. Also, please remember to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and push the little bell button to receive notifications about our upcoming new videos. Thank you for watching. Have a pleasant rest of the day and take care of yourself. Goodbye.